Crafty Gemini. I post weekly videos right here on my YouTube channel, and in this video tutorial, I'm gonna teach you how to make my Confetti Charm Quilt. To make a Confetti Charm Quilt, you're gonna need 2 yards of your background fabric, and then a pack of 42 squares that are 5 inches by 5 inches. The little neutrals pack that I'm using here happens to have 42 in it, so that is gonna be perfect. You can always cut out your own 5 inch by 5 inch squares or use some other packs that you may have similar to this one. Now I'm going with a little bit of an odd combination here. Most people are probably wondering what I'm doing, but I've made several of these quilts and I really like playing a lot with color and contrast. So we're gonna go with this yellow in the background, and the neutrals here vary from like whites and cream colors to grays, darker grays, browns, and even blacks. So I think this is going to be a really cool quilt to whip up, and this is the one I'm going to use to teach you how to make my Confetti Charm Quilt. Now before we start cutting into the background fabric, I will mention that I'm using just 2 yards of fabric because the selvages on my fabric are not that wide. If you're using a print or a solid that has really wide fabric selvages here and you're gonna have to trim a lot off of the width of the fabric, then you may end up with strips that are a little bit shorter than what you actually need to complete this quilt top. So in that case, I would say get at least 2.5 yards of your background fabric. Now let's start cutting. First thing is, from our background fabric, we're gonna cut out 5 strips that measure 3.5 inches wide by the width of the fabric. I trimmed off just a little teensy bit there to make sure that I'm starting off the edge of my strip cuts with a nice straight edge. And now I'm going to measure with a smaller ruler 3.5 inches in from this freshly cut edge. So 3.5 is right here. And I know some people like to put grippy things on their ruler so they don't move. I actually prefer not to, because I like to measure, especially when I'm cutting strips. I want to make sure that I can tweak the long strip ruler as I slide this one down, making sure that I'm maintaining that 3.5 inch measurement all the way up the entire strip. So that's one. And remember, when we say the width of the fabric, it's from selvage to selvage. So if you purchase the fabric from a bolt in a fabric store, it's going to come already folded like this, where the two selvages are touching. So along that grain line is that you want to measure 3.5 inches and cut the whole way. So I'm going to continue cutting to get a total of 5 strips. After I cut a couple of strips, I like to go back and remeasure and see if I've kind of been veering off of the straight edge that I need. So you can see that I was off by a little bit there. So I'll re-trim it up so it's nice and straight and continue to cut my remaining strips. Now from these 5 strips, we are going to subcut them down into smaller rectangles. First, I'm going to trim off my selvages. And then we're going to subcut these down into little chunks that measure 3.5 by 5 inches. So if you recall, from here to here was our 3.5 inch measurement. So from here to here, to where I make my next cut, I'm going to cut them out at 5 inches. So basically a bunch of 5 inch increments is where you're going to be making your cuts. And basically each of these strips are going to yield you 8 of the rectangles that we need, because remember, they're folded up in half. So every time I make a cut, I'm going to get 2. So I should be able to get 8 from each strip, and we're only going to need 35 total. So I'm going to come here, measure my 5 inches in from that cut edge. And it should be 3.5 inches by 5. That's 2, 4. And there are the 8 that we get from 1 strip, and this is the waist. So set that aside, and we're going to repeat the exact same thing to the remaining 4 strips. Now, a really quick recap. We started off with 5 strips, and each strip gave me 8. I've cut up, obviously, 4 of the strips. So 8 times 4 strips gives me 32. And remember, we only need 35. That means that I don't have to cut up this whole strip. I can leave some of it, and that way I can use it later in a future project. And we only need to cut 3 more out, okay? So we'll trim selvages. And because it's doubled up, I'm just going to go ahead and cut out 4. But you don't have to cut the whole strip from this one. There's 2. And there's 4. So that's going to give us a total of 36. And we can set one of these aside because we'll only need 35. Now we'll take these 35 rectangles, we'll set them aside, and go ahead and grab the remaining yardage you have from your background squares, because we still need to go back and cut up some more strips from this yardage. So we are going to start with the first cut. We need 6 strips that measure 3.5 inches, again, by the width of the fabric. So same dimensions, super simple. And I'm going to go ahead and cut out 6 strips at 3.5 inches, just like we did before. Alright, so now we have 6 strips that were cut at 3.5 inches wide, again by the width of the fabric. So just flip those up, set them aside, and we're going to go back and finish cutting off from this yardage. We're going to cut 6 more strips, except this time they are going to measure 4.5 inches wide. So if these measurements confuse you at all, consider putting a little piece of painter's tape on your ruler so you can remember and differentiate between the 3.5 inch strips and the 4.5 inch strips. But I like to kind of separate them out, so I'm cutting them all the same size at the same time so I can keep that measurement number in my head and I won't run into any problems. Especially if you're limited on the yardage that you're using. If you're like really working with just exactly 2 yards of the fabric that you want to work with, it's going to be tight, so make sure you pay attention to those cuts. Freshen up this edge so it's nice and straight for me. And now we'll cut 6 strips that measure 4.5 inches wide. And now that we're done cutting up our yardage, let's quickly recap what you should have at this point, because after this, you're ready to start piecing your confetti charm quilt. We have 35 rectangles that measure 3.5 inches by 5. We have 42 squares that are 5 inches by 5 inches, and that's this stack here. We have 6 strips that measure 3.5 inches wide by the width of the fabric. And then we cut another 6 strips 4.5 inches by the width of the fabric. And once you have all this, like you see it here, we are ready to start piecing together our quilt top. So now I'll open up my little pack here of 5-inch squares. And at this point, I typically like to start doing the whole layout on my design wall, because that's where you want to kind of lay everything out so you see it, and that way you can make sure and guarantee that you're not going to be sewing 2 things to the wrong place, because there's a lot of kind of background spaces that alternate with these blocks. So I'm going to first lay out the first row here so you kind of get an idea of the pattern of how it goes, and then we'll head over to the design wall and I'll show you how I lay it all up there, okay? So first, you're going to start off with a square of your stack. Now, if you're using one like I am that has a variety of colors that are kind of in the same family type of thing, you may want to kind of just mix them up. I don't really put too much time into thinking where which one is going, but I do know that because this is such a light background fabric, I really don't want to have like 2 cream ones right next to each other. So really, sometimes I just kind of spread them out on my table and then I just grab from the stack and use whatever I feel like doing. Once it's up on the design wall, and that's actually another reason I like to do it, is to lay out the design layout on the wall, is because you can stand back and have a look and decide like, oh, these 2 are a little bit too close in color, let me move them around. And at that point, you can swap out all the 5-inch squares until you have an overall layout that you really like, then you can start sewing. So another thing that I would like to note here, the background fabric that I'm using is not really a solid. It's more like a tone on tone, a lighter yellow background with a darker yellow of these little geometric triangles in it, okay? If you are really particular about which way these triangles are pointing, then I would suggest that for this quilt, you probably don't want to use it as your background fabric. I would stick to something that's more like a solid. I've made several of these quilts with solids, and I really want to play with the more geometric prints. And I am somebody who tends to use a lot of kind of what we call geos, these geometric prints that are tone on tone like this, as solids. So this doesn't bother me if I have the triangles going one direction and then in the next thing they're going up, and the strips if they're upside down or not. Sometimes I will actually do that on purpose, but just another little thing to keep in mind when you're choosing your fabrics. All right, so the first thing we're going to start off with is one of the 5-inch squares. Let me grab a dark one, I think, to start with. This is going to be, say, our first top row across the top. I'm going to start off with a 5-inch square, and then I'm going to alternate them with the 3.5-inch by 5-inch rectangle. If you notice, if you've made quilt blocks before, this is going to be our sashing, because it's going to be a spacer between this 5-inch square and the next one. So then we'll come in here and put another one, and then, as you guessed it, put another one of these. So this is what's creating kind of that grid design in the overall background fabric that's going to allow these little 5-inch squares to kind of look like little confetti charm thingies floating in the background fabric. All right, so just continue alternating, and you're gonna work your way across like this so that you're starting with a charm square, and I also want you to end with a charm. It's gonna be 6 charms across the top, at least that's how I designed it to be, and then you're gonna have 7 charms going down. So that's the main grid of the full design layout. 6 of these guys across by 7 down. All right, so here we have our basic design layout in the way that I told you. 6 of the 5-inch squares going across by 7 of them down, and then with the 3.5-inch by 5-inch rectangles separating them kind of as they're sashing. And I just kind of grabbed one square from the stack and put them up there. So now I can stand back and I'll kind of start to like swap some of the colors around. If I feel like there's too many darks in one area, like you can kind of see right here, this is kind of like a little bit too many darks right in this one area for me. So I'll probably go ahead and swap them out with some of the lighter ones. Now, my camera here, I can't show you the whole thing, but I'll kind of pan down so you can see the last row at the bottom. Remember, it's 6 across by 7 of the blocks down. Now, if you're working with a large design wall like I have here, in case you're wondering, you can see it's not anything fancy. I just have a piece of batting push pinned into the drywall here in my studio. I went ahead and laid everything out, and notice there's spaces in between each of the rows. We're going to go back in there with some of our other strips and fill it in with the remaining sashing. And that's what's basically, you're sashing the top and the bottom of each row. So it's going to look like the little individual squares are floating in the overall background of the quilt. Okay. And I think once you put those strips in place, that also will help you kind of visually see what the finished quilt will look like. And you can go back and swap the little squares out and kind of put them in an orientation or kind of in an overall layout design that you think is pleasing to your eye. Now, usually at this point, I like to go ahead and sew each one of the strips together in the same orientation at which they are. So I'll grab all those and kind of sew them the same one over and then sew the other one on until I complete all these 7 individual rows. Then I'll go back with my strips and fill them in. But so you start to get an idea of what the overall quilt is going to look like, we are now going to grab our 6 strips that measure 3.5 inches wide. And I'm going to go in beginning under the first patchwork row, okay, and fill in these spaces with the 6 strips, the 3.5-inch wide ones. All right, so I just put up a couple of the strips. You can see that there's 4 that have been inserted. Now, you may be looking at this and wondering why it's so short. Well, the reason it's so short is because the pieces are up top, the 5-inch squares with the little side sashing pieces, haven't been sewn together yet. And obviously, we need to account for the seam allowance across every single one of those seams that we need to sew together. And once that top strip of all those patchwork pieces is sewn together, then you'll see that you'll have plenty to sew it to with the strips that are underneath it. So that's kind of another reason I like to go ahead and just piece all the rows together and then go back and add the strips. But just so overall you can kind of see how it's going to look, it's like this gridded sashing around each one of the charm squares. All right, so right now I think I'm going to go in and play around a little bit with these charm squares and swap them around until I get something that I like. Again, I'm going to get rid of all this dark, kind of these dark squares that are right here. I want it a little bit more sprinkled around. So I'll work on that, and then I'll meet you back here after I've sewn together the individual rows before we start to piece the entire quilt top together. All right, so I have pieced together these rows, okay? The 7 rows that have 6 blocks across, and you can see they're all pieced together. So I went ahead and stuck them back up here. And now you can see that if you use that 1/4 inch seam allowance, after it all comes together, you can see it's significantly shorter. And so now our continuous strips here match up perfectly. There should be just a little that extends on each side, and that's your selvages. So you wanna make sure that you trim that off, and we will do that once we start to sew all these together. So now it's just a matter of super simple piecing, where we're gonna sew this to this to this to this, and you just work your way down the entire quilt. I have to go back in here and insert the remaining strips, but remember, the ones that you're putting in here are the ones that measure 3.5 inches wide, and we cut them by the width of the fabric, so you should have 6 of those. They're gonna go, they start, the first one starts underneath this first row, so that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So you shouldn't have any of those strips on the outer edges of your quilt top. Does that make sense? Because we're gonna go back and add strips to the sides, but that's for the next step after this. For right now, I'm gonna go ahead and sew all of the straight or solid strips to my pieced ones, and I'll have the whole quilt top up here for you to see. Now for sewing these two together, I like to just leave the selvages on my strips, so I will just start sewing a little bit down from the selvage, making sure that I'm not sewing into the other selvage, and then after I sew them all, I'll go back and trim all the little excess that's sticking out on both ends. I'll trim them off at that point. But let me sew these up, and I'll meet you back here when I have all this pieced together. All right, so here it is all pieced together. As you can see, we've gone ahead and pieced together the rows that had the 6 blocks by 7 blocks down, and then obviously alternating in between each one of those pieced rows, we have the solid strip that we went in and pieced in there. Now, before we can go ahead and grab our other strips and add kind of borders to the entire thing so that the little squares look like they're more floating inside a background fabric space, we definitely need to go in and trim off all these little excess selvage strips that are sticking out on the ends of the solid strip rows. So I'm gonna grab the quilt from here, I'm gonna trim it all up, and then we'll get into adding the exterior borders. So I'm gonna grab a strip ruler here, get everything to lay nice and flat. And because we have these solid rows, if your seam allowances were pretty straight, you can use the seam lines where the strips connect here as a guideline to line up with one of the straight lines on your ruler. And that way you know that the edge that you're going to follow to trim up is going to be straight as well. All right, we're going to trim a little bit off of everything because we need it to reach all the way across. So now you should still have 6 remaining strips that measure 4.5 inches wide by the width of the fabric how we cut them. We're going to piece 2 sets of 2, so here's 2 and here's 4, and then these 2 are going to stay by themselves. So grab 2 of these, we're going to trim the selvages off of them, and we're going to piece them together to make 1 longer continuous strip. Now to piece 2 strips together, it's the same way we do our quilt binding. So we have 1 strip vertically in front of us, pretty side facing up. The other one goes perpendicular to it, going this way. It's basically like a backwards L shape facing you. And the pretty side of the fabric goes face down. We're gonna match up raw edges on the side and at the bottom. And you're gonna draw a line from the top right corner to the bottom left. I'm gonna use a ruler and a marking pen so you all can see it. And this is gonna be our stitch line, okay? Put some pins if you need them.
And then you're going to stitch that right on that line at the sewing machine. I'm going to go ahead and prep the other two strips the same way since we need to repeat this. And then I'll take it over to the sewing machine and show you how to sew it. Okay, so we stitched on the line, remove our pins, and then I just measure 1/4 inch away from that seam allowance line and trim away this excess fabric. We'll give this a press, and I tend to open the seam here just to reduce some bulk, but you can also just press it to one side. And there you have one continuous strip for the side borders, okay? Same thing to the other one. All right, so now I want you to grab all your strips, the two ones that you still have that you haven't done anything with, and then these two longer ones that we just created, and let's head over to the design wall. The regular strips that we haven't done anything to are going to go on the top and the bottom, and I like to attach those first. Make sure that you attach these first, because if you attach the side borders and then go back and attach these are not going to be long enough to account for the entire width of the quilt plus the added borders on each side. So it's really important in this design, we're making the most out of the fabric we have, and you want to make sure that you're attaching these top and bottom borders first, okay? So that one's going to go piece there. And this one down here at the bottom. After we sew the top and bottom borders, then we'll go back and attach these longer ones, and you can see that now we have plenty of fabric to account for the finished length of the quilt top. So this is gonna go here, and obviously you will trim off any excess that you don't need. And this one will go here. And then you can see that after we piece everything together, you end up with a really nice size lap quilt. After you attach the top and bottom borders, make sure that you press after every seam and that you also go back and square it up again before we go back and attach the side borders. We can't have any of this excess sticking out. I like to use a square ruler because it gives me two straight sides here. So I know when I trim, this is a perfect 90 degree angle corner, perfect for me to attach the next border. Alright, so here you can see my finished Confetti Charm quilt top. It's a great size to give to really anybody of any age. If it's for a baby or a child, they can grow with it. And if it's for an adult, I think it makes a great lap size quilt. Now I wanted to show you another one of my Confetti Charm quilts that I made. And it's already been quilted and bound and everything, so this is the finished quilt itself. In case though some of you out there were maybe wondering what it looks like in a different color combination, here's a great one. Don't feel like you have to be limited to using a white or a light gray or some type of light neutral colored background. As you can see, the 5-inch squares that I use for this quilt are super like fun and bright colors, and they have absolutely nothing to do with this light aqua color that I use as a solid background, but I think it looks great. So feel free to step outside of the box and consider using a fun, solid, and bright color as your background fabric. And here I want to show you one more variation for something a little lighter and fresher. Obviously, it's not finished. I still have to add the exterior borders, but this is another variation of the confetti charm quilt that I made using just a solid white fabric for the background, and then 5-inch squares that I cut out from yardage of my first fabric collection. This is from my Dominicana fabric collection, and if you notice, you can really see some of the large scale prints, like these florals, these little house prints here and here. We have guavas. Some of these larger scale prints, even though we're using them just in 5-inch by 5-inch square pieces, I think they're really still nice enough to show off a large scale print like some of the ones that I have in my fabric collection. So if you have some fabrics in your stash that feature some larger scale designs and motifs, consider making a confetti charm quilt and cutting them up into 5-inch squares so that you can make a quilt to feature them. And that's also a quickie little project that you can whip up in a weekend.
So that's it for my confetti charm quilt tutorial. I hope you enjoyed learning how to make it and that you will give this project a try. I especially like to have this pattern on hand when I need a last minute quilt project to crank out. So keep that in mind if that happens to you as well. As you can see, it doesn't even matter what colors or what fabrics you choose. I tend to think that the pattern looks great no matter what you use. But I'd love to hear what you plan to use when you give the confetti charm quilt pattern a try. So go ahead and leave me a comment below and let me know the colors, maybe the color choices, and what you plan to use as your background fabric. I myself have quite a few more of these to crank out, and I'm even gonna play around with maybe using black or dark gray as the background fabric. I think that might look kind of funky. So if you make this project, definitely go ahead and upload pictures because I want to see what you're out there making from my Crafty Gemini tutorials. You can upload pictures directly to my Facebook page, or you can post them to your Instagram account and go ahead and tag me using the hashtag CraftyGemini. If you enjoyed the video, make sure to hit it with the thumbs up below, share it across the different social media sites, and as usual, don't forget to click the subscribe button so you don't miss out on any of my future videos. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Hope you all enjoyed it and that you'll give it a try. Remember, you don't even... What was I gonna say? This as a go-to project when I have a last-minute gift that I need to make. So if you make it, leave me a comment below and let me know what kind of color choices or color combinations you think are going to look great when you make this... What in the f*** am I talking about?